On this Friday the 13th, NASCAR itself has been no stranger to mysterious driver disappearances. I mean, God knows what Carl Edwards has been up to since hanging up the helmet. He went from laps away from hoisting his first NASCAR Cup championship to abruptly announcing his retirement and disappearing into the Midwest cornfields. Some drivers control their destiny while many others instantly get snapped into irrelevance. Kelly Bires is one of those examples. He's been a driver I've constantly asked over the years, what the hell happened? So today on this brand new series, we're going to crack the mystery and find out what Kelly Bires is up to now. The thing most notable to Kelly Bires in his racing career was that he climbed up the ladder the old school way. Through go-karting and late models, he won races and the 2006 ASA Championship. You could say at a very, very young age that Kelly Bires had a special niche for racing. 2007, the born and raised cheesehead would finally set foot in a NASCAR stock car. Kelly Bires was scheduled to start 19 races in the NASCAR Truck Series, driving the historic Wood Brothers 21. Through the first six races, Bires had an immense amount of crashes and mechanical issues that truly hindered excelling out of the gate. A 10th place finish would be his flagship result before his Truck Series tenure was brought to an abrupt hiatus. John Wood, the grandson of Wood Brothers' great Glenn Wood, was constantly battling medical issues. That forced him to withdraw from the ride, and as a result, leaving the Tad Geschichter 47 car vacated. At the time, JTG had a technical alliance with the Wood Brothers, and with that, Kelly Bires was baptized into competitive Xfinity racing. In just his second career start, Bires showed he was a prospect with potential. He took a 47 car with just one top 10 finish prior in the first 15 races to the front at Kentucky. Five laps led on that hot summer night with a respectable 7th place finish. Unfortunately, from that point, the equipment caught up and Bires stalled the remaining 1.5 seasons with the team. Honestly, I would say the main thing here that restricted Kelly Bires excelling relied with JTG themselves. Scott Zipadelli and the 47 team just weren't on the levels of, say, Roush Fenway Racing or Richard Childress. It was a solid ride, just not the one that Kelly Bires needed to exceed. But according to facts only, Kelly Bires had a higher average finish in 2018 than Jimmy Johnson. And you have to keep in mind, this was the same year he won his record-tying third championship. Unfortunately, JTG would move up to Cup in 2009, taking loyal companies Kingsford and Clorox to the new entry. The team's Xfinity program chose to disinfect itself from Bires after the common plague known as sponsorship affected JTG. I would say this move introduced Kelly Bires to the harsh world of late 2000s Xfinity. You had Cup drivers such as Kevin Harvick, Kyle Busch, and Carl Edwards racing on a weekly basis and dominating the competition. Now, I don't put the blame on these teams in particular. These drivers, they brought tons of sponsorship, ones potentially vying to eventually move into a role in Cup. That's what eventually happened with Fastenal and Jimmy John's, as starting in Xfinity, they worked up to the Cup Series and are currently sponsors today. Unfortunately, this era in particular was a truly dark time for driver development. If you subtract the Cup Series regulars, Kelly Bires would have ranked an impressive 5th place in the 2008 standings. But of course, no sponsors were going to take notice of Bires overperforming in 13th, because there are bigger, more marketable names out there winning races and competing for the championship. Circa, that's why the Rookie of the Year class was incredibly weak from 2010 to 2013. Kelly Bires, because of that culture, became a journeyman in the NASCAR Xfinity Series garage. He would race for 5 different race teams spanning the manufacturer nameplates of both Chevrolet and Toyota. That included some start and parking for both Braun Racing and MSRP Motorsports. Undoubtedly, his best opportunities came with driving the KHI 33. Kevin Harvick, the primary driver for the entry, elected to sit out a majority of the standalone races. For the little events known as Nashville, Kentucky, and Memphis, Bires would race winning equipment. That included a hardcore jam session in the Music City, finishing 4th and even beating Cup regulars Carl Edwards, David Reagan, and Michael McDowell. At this point in his career, you'd think Kelly Bires is a phone call away from getting the opportunity of a lifetime. He finished 5th at Iowa driving Braun Racing, typically a start and park car. But because in that race it was sponsored by FOE, he got to run the full race, and he did pretty well. With the proper funding, this kid could be something special and prove he had immense talent behind the wheel. Finally, on September 15, 2009, Kelly Bires was announced to Junior Motorsports. Turns out Dale Jr. developed a strong personal connection with Bires himself, and always longed to see what he could do in top-tier equipment. The duo inked a two-year deal, which was supposedly good through the 2011 season. After sorting out the JRM lineup, Bires would take over the 88 formerly driven by prospect Brad Keselowski. Tony Urey Sr., the mastermind behind Bad Brad's success, reprised his role as the 88's crew chief. This was the chance for Kelly Bires to make his name bright and earnest alongside the beaches of Daytona. That was the case until, once again, Leaching would screw over Kelly Bires. This time, sponsor Hellmann's wanted Dale Jr. to race the season-opening Daytona 300. At Unilever's obligation, NASCAR's most popular driver double-dipped to give the Mayo condiment more marketing exposure. He would race the 88, the same team in which Bires was scheduled to race for the championship. The team's second entry for Daytona was then devoted to Danica Patrick, a part of her few select races with the neon green and orange colors of GoDaddy. So I'm sure many of you could guess which driver was the one watching Daytona from his living room sofa. Finally, after years of dreaming for this opportunity, Kelly Bires rolled into Hollywood with Hollywood aspirations. His first race in competitive JRM equipment was rather solid. 7th place, just one spot short of ranking as the highest series regular. Then an early crash at Las Vegas brought things back down to earth. 3 team-level finishes at Bristol, Nashville, and Phoenix rounded out the skittish spring beginnings. When I look at the numbers for Kelly Bires in 2010, I mean, they weren't good, but you figured improvement was going to take place over time. You've got to remember, he was primarily a start and park driver in 2009. He barely got any competitive starts besides the few with Kevin Harvick Incorporated and the one with Braun Racing. As the season went on, he was going to progress in Junior Motorsports equipment and potentially become the next Brad Keselowski. Apparently, Junior Motorsports didn't get the memo. 3 days after the Phoenix race, Kelly Bires was released from his contract. Established Cup veteran Jamie McMurray would race the 88 for 9 races, with Unilever utilizing its Hellmann's and Swab products for those events. Honestly, this was not a good look for JRM. It seemed like there were a constant carousel of different drivers and personnel changing year to year. Now, Dale Earnhardt Jr. eventually responded by stating this: "You go through a lot of deals in this garage with the best expectations, so I don't know how it looks any stranger than anything else that's happened in the past. We're looking for the next Brad Keselowski, the next Jeff Gordon, whoever you want to compare him to. We're looking for that next guy, and you've got to get him in the race car." Another thing suggested by the boss man relied with the chemistry between Bires and crew chief Tony Urey Sr. Dale Jr. stated, "Bires and JRM just weren't clicking. We weren't getting along." Obviously, good chemistry in this league is ultra critical for lasting success. For whatever reason, Tony Urey Sr. and Kelly Bires just didn't develop that connection. Maybe you can pinpoint that on their beginnings, as Tony Urey Sr. and Kelly Bires came from slightly different backgrounds. Or there were some rumors that Kelly Bires didn't take getting benched for Daytona very well. Possibly that strained Kelly Bires' relationship not only with Tony Urey Sr., but the organization as a whole. As for a bit of the fallout of this operation, this started the dark age of Junior Motorsports from 2010 to 2012. They never really had a driver in contention for the championship, and some of their drivers like Danica Patrick and Cole Witt never materialized. And as for Kelly Bires, his career started to fizzle out after this endeavor. He did make 2 starts with Joe Gibbs Racing in 2011, which included an 8th place finish in the non-companion Chicago race. He would also make 3 career starts in the NASCAR Cup Series. For those of you guessing at home, it was for an underfunded start and park ride. Seemingly after those races, Kelly Bires just kinda disappeared and would never race in NASCAR again. So since disappearing off the NASCAR circuit, what has Bires done with his time? As of recent, Bires was inducted into the Mauston Wrestling Club Hall of Fame after winning 2 state wrestling championships in high school. Fun fact, he was actually recruited to wrestle at a few top-ranked colleges, but he turned them down to pursue his career in racing. Bires currently owns KBR Performance, a company that specializes in building and fabricating stock cars. Located in Linden Station, Wisconsin, KBR thrives to be the best with a retail store full of basic stock car and accessory needs. it's safe to say Kelly Bires isn't doing too bad on his own. It's just a shame his NASCAR career never panned out because Kelly Bires reminds me a lot of Alex Bowman. He was an underrated driver and incredible talent that just never got the break to make it big. And so that'll do it for this first installment of this new series. If you have any recommendations or what more you would like to see, make sure to leave your comments down below. Also, make sure to like, share, and of course, hit that big red button below. So anyways, this is NRF signing out, and just remember, life's a beach and then you drive.